What about carbohydrates, processed refined carbohydrates, and their effect on small dense LDL particles?
Right. So
you're talking about context, right?
Right. The food. That's right. So that takes me back to the nutrition committee again. So I started, as I said, I've been involved in lipoprotein research for a long time, and dietary effects on lipoproteins as part of our program. And I got into the American Heart Association nutrition activity really as a result of that, of that interest. And in addition to inheriting this confusion between dietary cholesterol, blood cholesterol in the general public, I also inherited from my colleagues and predecessors in the field the mantra that we should be going for low-fat diets. There was a very strong campaign to keep the message simple and stay away from fat. And there were a lot of forces in society as well as in the academic and industrial worlds that had an interest in pushing that that message as a way to keep the public focused on what they felt was the most important thing they should be doing, was restricting fat and saturated fat in particular. But what nobody really thought about seriously was the unintended consequence that that message, which the food industry responded to in its in a very responsible way. They said, well, the experts in the field are telling us to use low-fat products, so we're going to make low-fat foods, and we're going to make low-fat cookies, and we're going to make low-fat snack wells, brownies and
butter,
and so there was this tremendous response, which led to a reduction in fat intake, and saturated fat levels did go down in the diet. But the trade-off was an increase in carbohydrates. So, getting back to your question, we became very interested in studying the effects of a low-fat diet on lipoprotein metabolism. And so the very first study I did when I came here to Berkeley and starting to do some dietary work was to test the effects of a low-fat diet, the traditional low-fat diet. This is, again, when I was trying to get involved with the Heart Association. I was still in that mode. I was thinking, well, low-fat diets are good. This is what my predecessors had said, and so maybe that's what we should be studying. And the hypothesis was that people with small LDL would have a good response, that we put them on a low-fat diet, their heart disease risk should go down. Well, it turned out that it was actually the opposite. We had a completely contrary result. We found that people who started off with large LDL, when they were put on a low-fat diet, actually made their LDL smaller. So it went exactly the opposite direction. And that was like an eye-opener to me. And I think it's still sort of somewhere percolating through the nutritional world. Not everybody has really understood the implications of this. But what we found shortly thereafter is it wasn't so much the low-fat aspect of the diet that was causing this to happen. It was the fact that we were substituting carbohydrates. High-carbohydrate diets can promote the production of these VLDL particles from the liver that make small LDL. So high-carbohydrates clearly push lipoprotein metabolism in the direction of atherogenic dyslipidemia. All the features, high triglycerides, small LDL, and to some extent a lower HDL. And so we've tried to sort of break down the dietary response into a more specific role of particular carbohydrates, because, as you know, carbohydrates cover a wide range of food substances, ranging from simple sugars like fructose and glucose to complex starches and fiber that are less easily metabolized and do not raise blood sugar levels the way the processed starches do. So we have been very interested in narrowing that down, and we and others have pretty much come to the conclusion that probably the chief culprits in the production of this atherogenic dyslipidemic trait on low-fat, high-carbohydrate diets are probably the simple sugars, and fructose in particular among them, which is, of course, a component of table sugar and added sugars. Half of that is fructose, the other half is glucose. So we think all carbohydrates have this potential for pushing lipid metabolism in that direction. But sugars, and particularly fructose, we think are the most potent. And this has flown in with a huge popular attention. Now, people really do understand, I think for the most part, that dietary added sugars have adverse effects not just on lipids or heart disease risk, but on many aspects of health and obesity, for example, being perhaps the biggest public health issue that has been associated with added sugars, particularly from liquids.